Okay, so good morning all. Today we are going to discuss that who all are required to get themselves registered under GST. As I discussed with you all in the previous lectures also, and give you a hint that any person who is taxable under GST, or you can say any person who on whom the tax has been levied under GST, are required to be registered under GST so that they can pay off their liability accordingly. So let's have the discussion that who all are required to get themselves registered under GST. One is the one, as I told you in the previous sessions also, that one who have the annual turnover beyond the threshold limit. So as we have discussed that there are the different states, there are different union territories, and there are different special category cases on which differently there is limit of 40 lakh, 20 lakh and 10 lakh. So accordingly, state-wise, they need to first check that for which state, for which union territory, or for which special category state they belong to, and accordingly the threshold limit changes. And also there is a change in the threshold limit for the goods and services also. Like in certain categories of states, there are threshold limit for goods 40 lakh and for services it is 20 lakh. So as per the list of states, union territory or the special category states, they are required, the supplier required to check themselves that to which state their business belongs to, and accordingly the threshold limit will be set for them. And if they have the annual turnover of which is going beyond that threshold limit, they need to get themselves registered. Then person making interstate supplies, any person who is involved in the interstate supply, which is going beyond the state boundaries for the supplies, they are required to get themselves registered. Then we talked about the e-commerce operator. E-commerce operator is basically the, you can say, the supplier who is actually not involved into manufacturing the goods, but it is usually giving services of having the digital platform so that they can take up the supplies from the manufacturers and supply it to the further consumer. So basically they act as a middleman in the supply chain. And they are not actually the users or consumers of it, neither they are the manufacturer. They are simply providing a digital platform, e-commerce platform to the manufacturers and to the users. So under this, we can take the example of all the shopping websites like Flipkart, etc., Amazon. These all are the considered as the e-commerce operators who are not the manufacturers. They are simply providing a platform to the consumers and to the manufacturers, that it gives a platform to the manufacturers who need to sell their goods, and it gives a platform to the consumers who need to purchase the goods. They go to the site, purchase, and have the supplies of that. So e-commerce operator basically provides a digital platform, and such type of suppliers are also required to get themselves registered under the GST Act. Then if there is a casual taxable person, we have discussed, it is a person who, it is a basically a supplier who does not have any fixed place of business, but still if he is supplying goods from a particular place, like for example, let's suppose there is a fair occurred, and in that fair XYZ seller is there who is supplying goods, and he don't have that, but he don't have his office set up in that particular place where he has participated in the business. So in that case, what he will do, he will get himself registered for the supplies he is doing in that fair for a tentative, let's say, the 90 days time period for which the casual taxable person will be registered. And whatever is the tax liability that has been fixed on him, he needs to pay advance tax for that. And after his actual supplies, after his actual sales occurs, he has already made with all his supplies, then the final settlement of his tax will be done. So in this case, where there is no fixed place for the business for which he is making the supplies, and he needs to get himself registered under the casual taxable person, and then this is a temporary registration which he gets for his temporary supply of goods or the services that he is doing. Once that purpose is done, his registration will stand cancelled, and his whatever advance tax he has done, that will be adjusted out of the actual amount of taxes that he needs to pay, and whatever is the more tax or the less tax, that will be adjusted accordingly. Then we talked about the reverse charge. Reverse charge mechanism is a situation where, as we have discussed in the previous lecture also, that where the supplier is not responsible for paying off the tax, though incidents fall on the buyer only, but under GST's framework, it is the responsibility of the supplier to pay off the tax to the government. But under reverse charge mechanism, it is the reverse scene where the buyer is liable to pay the tax to the government. So that situation can be, maybe due to the person who is supplying, the supplier here is not a taxable person. In that case, he has not got himself registered. If he is not registered, he cannot pay the tax on those supplies. So under that, the reverse charge mechanism will happen, and the person who is purchasing the goods will pay off the taxes. Then next point, it says if you are required to pay tax under section 9, subsection 5, and deduct tax at source. See, tax at source is being deducted by the supplier. So any person who is deducting tax on the basis of that tax deducted, you are required to get yourself registered and accordingly pay off the taxes. So here, when we say that tax deducted at source, tax deducted at source simply means that when in the case of e-commerce operator, it is required to deduct tax at source. So when you are, or in any other case, when you are deducting tax at source, then you need to be specifically get yourself registered. Just say in GST case, it has been very clearly given here that if any supplies is occurring in the intrastate supplies, I'm talking about what is specifically written here under this section 9 subsection 5, is that under this category, all the e-commerce operators are required to pay tax in respect of intrastate supplies of specified categories of services, like which includes the transportation of passengers, which includes the accommodation and housekeeping services. So if these services are provided by any of the e-commerce operators, then in that case, you need to provide, you need to get yourself registered and pay GST under it. So under this requirement, if you are deducting tax at source, or you are providing any such services, then in that case, you are required to be registered. Then if you are a non-resident liable to pay taxes producing taxable supply. Yes, this is also important. It simply says that non-resident here means any person who is having the status of non-resident of India, NRI. This you have already studied under the income tax. I'm not going into detail with that, because in income tax, you have already studied what is NRI. So that exactly that condition will apply here also under GST for assuming what is NRI. So in case when a person is a NRI and he is supplying goods to India, or if that person is not having any specific place of business but is still supplying goods in India, goods or services, whatever, in India, then in that case he is liable to pay the taxes under GST. So for this, there is a special clause for NRIs, though they are not the residents of India, but since any person having NRI status and do not have any fixed place of business but still supply goods or the services to India, then in that case, that person becomes liable to pay off the taxes under GST on the supplies that is being made. Then, next it says the input service distributor. This is an important point to discuss over here. Input service distributor is, as you can see here, it is basically the services provided by a business to its different branches, for which all the branches are liable to take the input tax credit. See, when I say input service distributor, it simply means that there are different branches of a business, and like there is one common service which is purchased by, let's say, the head office or one of the branches, and it has been taken off by the other branches of the business also. So in that case, when any sort of such services is being purchased by one branch and is being distributed, or you can say the head office, it might happen that head office has purchased certain services or certain goods, and it is being further distributed to the other branches. Like, for example, it can be any common software that is being used. So let's say the software that we are having, like in college, whatever ERP we are using, that ERP we have purchased from a particular vendor, but we are using it to all the other campuses also. So the head office that has purchased, or one branch that has purchased, will become the input service distributor, and all the other branches will be using it. So that will be considered as a supply in this case, and whatever is the input tax credit that is being received will be received by all the branches, and the service that is being used or purchased is, you can say, it will be used, and the invoices will be generated by each and every branch. So it will be considered as a proper supply, though one branch or the head office has distributed this service to the different branches, but for these services, there will be invoice generated, and there will be equal or proportionate, you can say, distribution of ITC received. So in that case, if this particular situation is there, we call it as the input service distributor. So one condition for this input service distributor is that the branches can have different GSTINs but have the same PAN. That simply means that all the branches of the business should be registered under the same PAN number, but they can have different GSTINs. Like for a GST payment purpose, they have different GST registrations, but all the registrations have been done under the same PAN number. So PAN number is the same, but since might be possible that all the branches have working in different states, so their registration is under the different GSTINs. So as the example here says, to make your understanding better, in this case for the input service distributor, I have taken up an example here. Like, head office of ABC Limited is located at Bangalore, having branches at Chennai, Mumbai, and Kolkata. The head office incurred annual software maintenance expenses on behalf of its branches and received the invoice for the same. Like, they have purchased this maintenance services, they have acquired this maintenance services, and all the branches are paying for such services. They have already generated the invoice for the same. Now, since software is used by all its branches, the input tax credit of entire services cannot be claimed at Bangalore. So, since all the branches have used these services, so it's not only the head office who can claim the ITC, all the branches can have this right to claim the ITC as they have generated the invoices also for the same. So the same has to be distributed to all the three locations. Here, the head office of Bangalore is the input service distributed. Since it has purchased, so it will be the input service distributed for which there all the branches have raised up the invoices and they have made payment, and accordingly they will be getting the input tax credit for their payment. And accordingly, they all must have been registered under the same PAN number, but they have their own different GSTINs, and that is why they are having their own proportion of, you can say, income tax credit. So any input service distributor, you can say, where you receive the invoices for the services used by its different branches, then that condition will be the input service distributor, and under which all the branches, they have the right to claim over the ITC that is being received by the by one branch or by the head office that is being that is that have purchased the services. So this is all the point that talks about the person who are required to get themselves registered under GST. Thank you all.